My dear people of God, today we are going to take a look from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1 to 11. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1 to 11. The Bible says, and I read, concerning spiritual gifts, brothers, we don't want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were led away to speechless idols in whatever way it happened. Therefore, I want you to know that no one speaking by God's Spirit says Jesus be cursed. But no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There is a variety of gracious gifts, but the same Spirit. There is a variety of services, but the same Lord. There is a variety of activities, but the same God who works all things in all ways. Now, to each one, the Spirit makes his gifts apparent for the common good. To one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To someone else, faith is given in the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing in the one Spirit, the Spirit of discernment, the Spirit of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment between spirits. To someone else, different gifts of language are given. To another, the interpretation of languages. But the one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each person properly, just as he wills. And this is the word of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, this was the message that God gave to the people of Corinth in the time of Paul. And he was giving them enlightenment concerning spiritual gifts. Now, our brother Paul had taken time to identify variety of different gifts that the Holy Spirit do give to people. He mentioned the gift of prophecy, the gift of speaking in tongues, of discernment. He talked about the gift of healing, and so on and so forth. My dear brothers and sisters, even in the book of Romans chapter 12, verse 6 to 8, our brother Paul was also talking about these same spiritual gifts. And he says, the Bible reading from Romans chapter 12, verse 6 to 8, he said, we have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Now, the reading that we just took now from Romans 12, verse 6 to 8, is taking us to where we are going to center today's ministration. But why we have started to take our reading from the book of Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1 to 11, is because I wanted to start from the things we are familiar with when we talk about God's gift. Already in our minds, especially during the Pentecost season, we talk of spiritual gifts. Are those spirits, those gifts that God do give to his people through his Spirit to enlighten the church and to edify the church? And we have already mentioned those gifts as the gifts of prophecy and so on and so forth. But now, in the book of Romans chapter 12, our brother Paul was now writing to the people of Romans, and he was not giving them this further enlightenment concerning spiritual gifts. Now, I am not surprised that Paul recorded the gift of prophecy again in Romans chapter 12, verse 6. He mentioned prophecy. But what is getting my attention, and which way I'm calling your attention to, is the fact that in Romans chapter 12, verse 7 down to 8, he was now talking about serving, the gift of service as a gift. He talked about teaching as a gift. Now, it may surprise you also that in verse 8, he talked about encouragement as a gift. And then he talked about the gift of giving. The gift of giving. He mentioned it as gifts. And he said, give generously. Then he talked about the gift of leadership. He said, if it is to lead, he said, do it diligently. And then he talked about mercy. He said, show mercy cheerfully. You see, when we talk about spiritual gifts, our minds often center on what God was talking about in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1 to 11, about the different spiritual gifts, especially as in the charismatic community. And during the Pentecost season, our minds always go to these different gifts of speaking in tongues and the interpretation of tongues and the miracles and prophecy and the healing and the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and so on and so forth. But what you are not aware is that leadership is a gift, and it's the Holy Spirit that gives it. That even the fact that you see people and you become compassionate to them and you don't have rest until you do the good to them is a gift. I do make a joke sometimes to my wife. I say, you have anointing for cooking, you know, so it's a gift. There are things that God has given to us, and we are supposed to identify these things as gifts of the Holy Spirit, as gifts that God Himself has given to us, and He wants to glorify His people. He wants to touch us in a special way. He wants to bring His salvation to us. But He wants to use you as an instrument to accomplish that. Now, if I may ask you a question, what are the gifts you have? What are your gifts? And I don't want to start thinking of, healing, miracles and discernment and tongues, or wisdom and knowledge and faith. No. I want you to start thinking of, beyond what you have been taking as spiritual gifts. That now, you could be called just for administration, even for shepherding, even for evangelism, even for apostleship, even for helping or assistance. That these are gifts. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 12, God even mentioned the gifts of evangelism and shepherding. These are gifts. Do you know there are people that when they are talking, they have insights? This is a gift. And these gifts, God used them to make ways for us, to clear ways for His people. He used these gifts to glorify Himself in the human community. And oftentimes we talk about people as, sometimes we say, some people say, this is a gifted child. But you know what? God has really given each and every one of us gifts. And you are really gifted. You have to see yourself as a gifted person. Because that's something that God has put in you. It is on this basis that we shall give this talk the title, You Are God's Gifted People. You are God's gifted people. In the Bible, we see so many stories of people that God have given special and amazing gifts. Jesus. The Bible has recorded so many great people. We talk about people like Adam and Eve, they were gifted. Noah was gifted. He didn't go to school to build that ark or Noah's ark. Abraham was gifted. Moses was gifted. David was gifted. Elijah, and even Elisha, Isaiah, even Mother Mary, Jesus, the ultimate, was gifted. Peter was, Paul was. What do they have in common? What they have in common is that their gifts made ways for them. And that brings us to Proverbs chapter 18, verse 16. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 16. The Bible says, a gift opens the way and ushers the giver into the presence of the great. In fact, King James Version would say, a man's gift maketh room for him and bringeth him before great men. I repeat, a man's gift maketh room for him and bringeth him before great men. Wow. So that means that the gift God has given to you is meant to bring you to greatness. That gift is meant to make you become a man or a woman who would fulfill life's purpose for your coming. That God has given you that gift, through that gift, that you will not live in darkness or in oblivion. But God wants to take you into greatness. That gift you have is meant to distinguish you. Oh, Jesus. And so, my brothers and sisters, the statement that God has told us in Proverbs 18, verse 16, about the gift of man being able to bring him before great men, it means a very powerful statement. It is a very powerful statement. It reveals a lot about the plan of God for you. He said that a man's gift, maketh way for him, maketh room for him. Wow. In other words, God has designed me, created me to be known for my gifts. Since my gift will make a way for me. That means God has created me, you know, that through my gift, the ways, doors will open for me. We live in a time when you are walking into a building and the doors are just opening on their own. And God is saying that without your input, your gift will make a way for you. Because God has given it to us. The doors will open. God gave us that gift out of his generosity. It was not our input. It was not because of our righteousness. And God wants us to exercise that gift. By exercising these gifts, we will find real fulfillment in life, real purpose, real contentment in our work. And so since Paul has given us further enlightenment on spiritual gifts in Romans 12, verse 6 to 8, where he talked about, servanthood and prophecy and teaching and leadership and compassion and so on and so forth, then it means that God himself wants to use us even to bring his kingdom into the world. Your gift may be the gift of leadership. Things may not move until you come. That's what it means. Because you have the gift of leadership. This is us. There are people, they may have the best qualifications. But you know what? If they don't have the gift of teaching, they will confuse even the students. Gift is different from education. Your gift may be singing. It may be leading in worship in the church or in the prayer line. God has specifically placed that purpose, that gift in you. It is very interesting to note that the Bible does not say that a man's education makes room for him. If the Bible had said that, people would have been comfortable with that. But the Bible says that it is a man's gift that make ways for him. The society we live believes that education is the key to success. I mean, this is what we have been hearing, this is what we believe, and this is what we teach our children. But you know what? There's a greater thing than that. Really, the Bible is telling us it is our gifts that really make way for us. It is our gifts that is the key to success. Society has made us to swallow that idea that education is the key to success. Jesus. I agree that education is wonderful. And while education can make education, let me tell you something. Education can't give you your gift, but it can help you to develop your gift. We have to understand this properly. All right? Education can help us to maximize our potentials. All right? If education alone were the key of success, then I would have a question to ask. Why is it that, not everyone that has PhD actually is happy in life, is actually successful in life? All right? If education alone were the key of success, then everyone who has a PhD, which is considered to be the highest academic attainment, all of them would be fulfilled in life. But not true. If you are intelligent, but you are not exercising your gifts, you are probably going to be poor. If you are educated, but you have not developed your talent, your gifts, you are likely to be depressed or frustrated or tired about life. Brothers and sisters, education in itself doesn't guarantee anything. It is your God-given gift that is the key to your success. And St. Paul has taken time today to bring us into this awareness, into this knowledge, so that we ask God to help us fan our gifts to flame. Your gift will make a room for you. When with that your gift, the world has no option than to key into your gifts. This is us. You don't realize that the gift you are sitting on is loaded. You don't consider that you are loaded with gifts. It is time for us to really reevaluate who we are. Reevaluate the gifts that God has given to us. And use them to glorify God, to serve God. desires. And you know one thing? The world cannot move forward without that your gift. If everybody in the world is using their gifts properly, then the world, I tell you, will be moving forward. It's ours. My dear brothers and sisters, today we are going to talk to God. We're going to ask Him to touch us. We're going to ask Him to let Him enable us to use our gifts, to develop ourselves, to use our gifts, to get to places, to use our gifts, our gifts open doors for us. The gifts of our brother Joseph opened doors for him, even in a foreign land. The gifts of David opened doors for him. There is no person as gifted that the door will not open for the person. That gift is meant to open the doors for you. This is ours. The gift of Prophet Isaiah opened the doors for him. The gifts of Queen Esther opened the doors for him. And I tell you, your own gifts are meant to open doors for you. And you will be remembered for that gift. Because of that gift, you'll be remembered. This is ours. Oh, do what you are born to do. Do what you are born to do. Because it is by doing that that you are living in the atmosphere of your gifts. When you are doing what you are born to do, then you find life's fulfillment. Is it no matter how big the world is, there is a place for you. And that place for you can only be discovered through your gift. The world will know you because of the gifts you have that have been used. Not buried gifts. There are gifts that are buried. There are talents that are buried. Remember the story of the talents. Somebody was given, you know, some money, and he went and buried it. And that was one of the parables of Jesus, the parable of the talents. The ones that buried their own gifts, Jesus was not happy with him or with them. But the ones that used the gifts and it got multiplied, he blessed them. And let me even tell you something. When you use your gifts for service of mankind to glorify God, then it will multiply. It will multiply. But when you don't use your gifts, and you go, that means you are burying your gifts, then it will not multiply. And then the world will not know you. I hear about a man called Michelangelo. Many of you know about him. He was a great artist. You know, he did great work in the world of the art. Until today, after 500 years, the world still remembers him. You hear me when I'm talking to you? Because somebody invented telephone. I use the phone, and I'm talking, you know, into the prayer line, to the human, into the prayer line community through the phone. Somebody invented that telephone. It was somebody's idea. Somebody was gifted that through that gift, the world would be able to know what communication really means. When he was talking about that idea, people were laughing at him. People were laughing. People thought he was mad. That man was Graham Bell. You know, Alexander Graham Bell. Many of you may have heard about him. Many of you may not have. But you know what? His gift is what we are using today. Can you talk about the cell phones? This thing started with someone's idea, someone's gift, someone who put his gift into reality. Oh, yes. Abraham Bell believed that sound could be converted into electricity and that it could be transmitted, you know, through the wire. And today it's true. The world remembers him for that. You see why I'm telling you? The world will remember you for your gift that was put into flame, that is put into reality. Don't bury that gift. All the people that thought that Alexander Graham Bell was mad and were criticizing him, none of them is in record in human history. No one remembers all the people that fought him, that fought his idea. All those people that said he was crazy, they are not remembered today. Nobody knows them. I don't even know them. There's no trace of them in history. But the man that stood his ground, his faith, his gifts, brought him into the reality of his purpose. His gift opened the room for him. You hear about the man called Michael Faraday. He came up with the idea of electricity. People thought he was mad, but he continued. He persisted. He pursued that gift. And God opened the door for him, and today we enjoy electricity, and you can imagine the world without electricity. The same thing with the man called Thomas Edison. Oh, Jesus. Can you imagine? Do you know that this aeroplane, somebody came up with that idea? Somebody came up with the idea that, oh, man could fly. Oh, my goodness. If you read about the Wright brothers, you know, the inventors of the force controlled, powered, and sustained aeroplane, you see that they were heavily criticized. But the gift in them was strong. They believed that indeed man could fly. You see, that one thing about people with your gift is that your gift convinces you that this thing is a reality. And that person is not seeing it, but you are seeing it in your mind sphere, in your mind, you are seeing it. The Wright brothers, we are criticized, but you know what? Today they are correct. Today we are entering aeroplanes, flying to different parts of the world, but they come up with the idea. Today we know them. We see their work. Jesus. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, the gift God has given to you is meant to make you unforgettable. It is meant to place you in history. Yes. It is meant to give you fulfillment in life. It is not the type of job you do that really gives you that fulfillment. It is living your gift that gives you that fulfillment. You know, when you live your gift, that is living in the atmosphere of your gift, then you become original. You become an innovator and not an imitator. When you are imitating somebody, you are not living your gift. Jesus was living his gift, and that's why history records him as the greatest innovator. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, having heard this message today, I have a question. Where is your gift? Is it buried? Where is it? In the ground? Jesus. There are people that their gifts are in the ground, buried. Oh. The Bible talk to us about the parable of the talents. Matthew chapter 25, verse 14 to 30 tells us, "For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another one, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also he who had 2 talents Merito talents more. But he who had received the one talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here, I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you above much more. I will set you much more. Jesus. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also, who had the 2 talents, came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here, I have made 2 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Oh, Jesus. Now, verse 24 continues. He also who had received the 1 talent came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid of you, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown, and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested your money with the bankers, and at my coming, I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it. To him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And they cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. My dear people of God, this was one of the parables of Jesus called the parable of the talents. And you see that the man that was given 5 talents and the one given 2 talents, they worked with those talents and they came up with dividends. They yielded fruits. Jesus. They brought more talents. And when the master came on the day of the recompense or the day of account, they now gave extra than what was given to them. And in each of the cases, God said, Well done, good and faithful servant. You know what that means? When you put your gift into practice, when you cultivate your gift, use the gift with humility to serve God, then you will bear fruit, and then God will now tell you, Well done, good and faithful servant. God sees you as good and as faithful servant. Now you see the definition of faithful servant, the one who is faithful to his gift that God has given to him. Jesus. So, the Bible tells us in John chapter 15, verse 16, he said, "You did not choose me, I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that lasts, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give it to you." You see what God is telling us? When you put your gifts into practice, you use it to serve God, you use it to bless people, then you bear fruit by that process. And then when you ask God for more, God will not give you more, because he has seen that you are productive, you are yielding fruit. God has appointed you and has put that gift in you for a purpose. Don't keep it alone. When you keep your gift alone and use it for your own selfish need, then it becomes selfishness. I am happy that the Bible says in John 15, verse 16, that when we use this gift and bear fruit, then whatever we ask in his name, he will give it to us. Do you see one of the ways to get things from God? That the ones you have been given to you, you have rendered a good account, you are using it properly? Jesus. Oh, when you are using your gifts properly, God will bless you. God sees you as a faithful servant. Look at what the Bible tells us about those two people that use their gifts, their talents properly. You know what he said? He said, "You have been faithful over a little. I will give you more." Do you want more gift from God? Then the ones they are giving to you, use it. Use it. You know, it's like a farmer planting a seed in the ground, like a corn. That corn will grow into a plant, and then will now bear fruit. And then one single corn, a seed of corn, can now give rise to hundreds of seed corns. But if it did not grow, then it cannot be able to bear fruit. It remains in the ground and they rot away. The Bible tells us that these master servants that were given little and they came up with extra, with dividends, that God credited them. God called them faithful servants. God gave them more. And God told them, "Enter into the joy of your master." Now listen again. When you are using your gift to do the work of God, to bless people, then you will be happy. You'll just be joyful. You'll just be joyful. I'm telling you. The Bible says, "Enter into the joy of your master, the joy of the Lord." But the man who was given one talent, and he just went and buried it in the ground. The day the master came, you look at the way he even talked to the master, very, very insulting. He just came forward and said, "Master, I knew you to be a hard man, always reaping where you didn't sow, gathering where you didn't scatter. You know, so I was afraid to invest the money. I went and I hid it in the ground, waiting for the day you come." And then he had the audacity to tell the master, "Take your money. Take your talent. Take your gift you're giving to me." Can you imagine? Can you imagine? We're not happy with that man. God was not happy with him. And you see what God told him? Say, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I scatter no seed. Then you should have invested that money in the bank. So that when I come, at least I'll get interest. But you went and buried it. And you know what God did? He took the talents away from you and gave to the one who had. So that the one who had would have more. And the one who was not using his gifts even lost the one he had. Now this brings us, confirms the point that when you use your gift, you get more. But when you don't use your gift, even the one you have, you lose it. My brothers and sisters, I have a question. Do you want your gift to multiply? Is your gift buried, or are you cultivating your gifts? Are you using your gift to serve God? Are you using your gift to bring joy to society? Is that what they are doing? We're asking the Lord Almighty today. Let him touch us. Let him help us. Let him give us the grace to use our gifts to serve him. Let him help us to be faithful servants. Servants who would use their gifts, their talents, to serve God. Oh, Jesus. Father, we ask you to remove from us every spirit of selfishness, every spirit of slothfulness, spiritual laziness, the spirit that made people to bury their gifts. Father, Lord, we stand against those spirits. As many that have buried their gifts, Father, Lord, we're asking for forgiveness of sins. We're asking you, Lord Almighty, in this moment of prayer, to bring into them the enlightenment to put their gifts into use, to fan their gifts into use, to put their gifts into use, to fan their gifts into flame, to stir up their gifts. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you. Jesus, my God and our Father, help us to stir up the gifts you have given to us. Help us to give good accounts of the gifts you have given to us in the name of Jesus. Father, touch us in a special way. Touch us in a special way. Touch us in a special way. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Help us to bear fruit, O Lord. Help us to bear fruit that glorifies you. We want to be called faithful servants. We want to be called good servants. Father, we want to hear you say, well done, my servant, my faithful servant. Father, even the little you have given to us, may we bear fruit so that you will give us more gifts, O Lord. Jesus. Father, we know that by living the gifts you have given to us, by living the atmosphere of the gifts you have given to us, that we shall have the joy of life, of living in you. Father, give us that joy, O Lord. Oh, Jesus. Father, touch us, O Lord. Blessed be your name, Papa. In the name of Jesus. Oh, we are going to remember that the people that have buried their gifts, we are going to pray for them. And the worst is that the devil even bury the talents, the destinies, the life of many people. And you see somebody, the person is struggling, and he's struggling, and nothing is going forward. Because the person's destiny or gifts have been buried, not willingly. In the case of the story of the scripture in Matthew chapter 25, we see the story of a servant who willingly buried his own gifts. But there are people that their gifts, you know, or destinies are buried not willingly. One of the typical and the classical examples in the scripture is the man called Jabez. In 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 9 to 10, the Bible told us about how this young man, Jabez, was living a life of pains, a life of misery. Nothing works for him. All right? Nothing moves for him. He was an object of misery. But he cried to God. He called on the God. He said, God, remember me. God, enlarge my cause. The Bible recorded that God heard him. And God multiplied him. God enlarged his cause. In other words, his gifts, his talents that were buried by the enemies, God was able to cause divine volcano to erupt and pull out his gifts. So many of us, our gifts have been buried in the ground and they are decaying there. But now we're going to pray and ask the Almighty God to send a divine volcanic eruption to pull out those gifts that are buried in the ground. If you have seen volcanoes, volcanoes usually reveal the things that have been down the ground, hundreds of miles into the ground, the golds in the ground, the diamonds in the ground, the precious stones, the gems that you know are in the ground. When the volcano eruption takes place, you see it revealing them, pulling them out. You see those things being pulled out. You know, they will be exhumed. We call them lava. I am praying today that there shall be a spiritual lava in your life. Because a divine eruption is going to take place to bring out those your goals, your diamonds, your glory, your destiny, your talents that have been buried over the years by the power of darkness. Oh, Jesus. Holy Father, the hour has come. The hour has come. You told us to ask that we shall receive. Now, Papa, we're asking you, Lord, to send your divine volcanic eruption in the life of your people so that their gifts that have been buried will be exhumed, will begin to be revealed, will begin to come out in the name of Jesus. Jesus, oh, you, my buried gifts, my buried potentials, my buried glory, my buried stars, my buried testimonies, my buried breakthroughs, I command you right now, in the name of Jesus, come out! I command the ground to release them now, in the name of Jesus. I command the land to vomit my blessings, in the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, my people pray now, my people pray now, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Pray now, pray now, pray now. All my gifts are buried. I command you now. Come out. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. The Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 29. He said, O earth, 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 listen to the message of the Lord. Oh. There was something in the earth in the time of Jeremiah that was very important to Jeremiah, but it was in the earth. It was buried. There was no drilling machine to drill the ground, to drill the earth, and for Jeremiah to get those blessings. But Jeremiah knew that when he prays, that God will cause divine volcanic reaction in the earth. And the earth will vomit what was buried. And that was why in Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 29, Jeremiah now cried out to say, Oh, earth, 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 hear the word of God. Three times. People thought that Jeremiah was mad. How could Jeremiah be commanding the earth and telling the earth to hear the word of the Lord? Does the earth have ears? Is that your question? But let me tell you. God heard Jeremiah. The earth listened to Jeremiah and vomited what Jeremiah wanted. In the time of Joshua, Joshua looked at the sun. He said, Oh, you sun, st- stand still. The Bible recorded that the sun stood still. Oh, Jesus. In the time of Moses, he said, oh, earth, open. And the earth opened. And they swallowed the rebellious tribe, the evil tribe. You see, the Lord is revealing this to us for us to know that today, as God answered Joshua and Moses, and as answered Jeremiah, and the unthinkable happened, that so shall the unthinkable, the things you could not imagine, also happen through his prayer today for you. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. I don't know where your own gifts have been buried. There are people that have gifts are buried in the sea. Buried in the sea. There are people that have gifts are buried in occultic kingdoms. There are people that gifts are put in the witchcraft covens, in satanic cupboards, and they are locked up. People that their marriages are locked up, that their children are locked up. People that their glories are locked up. Oh, Jesus, I am calling upon Jesus. Let him cause volcanic reaction, volcanic eruption in that very water. Oh, I command that padlock that have been used to padlock your glory. Those your blessings that are put in the warehouse. Your finances that have been locked up in the warehouse. Your finances that have been locked up in the spiritual bank. I am calling upon Jesus. Let him come and answer. In the name of Jesus. Let him come and answer. Let him break the power of the devil. Let him destroy them now. Let him destroy their powers. In the name of Jesus. Call upon Jesus. Call upon Jesus. He is a mighty God. Call upon Jesus. Father, answer. My Lord and my Father, come with your power. Come with your power. In the name of Jesus. Come with your hammer. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Come and break the way open. Come and make a way, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Come and break open the gate with your hammer. So that your people will come out. So that your destiny will come out. Oroboshereba. Jesus. Jesus. My people pray now. Call upon Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. People that their finances are in the coffin. Financial coffins. We command them now, in the name of Jesus, be broken now. Jesus, people that their talents are buried in coffins, make a robo sereba. May the power of Jesus appear. Let the power of Jesus appear, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, Jesus, the Bible says in the book of Micah, chapter 2, verse 13, the one who breaks open the way, we go before them. They will break through the gates and they will come out. Their king will pass through before them. The Lord at their head. The Bible is saying that Jesus is a breaker. He will break open the gates. He will break open the coffin. He will destroy that limitation. And your destiny will come out. And as he's breaking it, as he's breaking that ancient gate, Horobo Sheneba. You will come out today in the name of Jesus. And Jesus will be in the front. And you follow him. Because the one who has the victory, the one who delivers, will have to be in the front. The one who breaks open the gates will be in the front. And the children who have been captives, who have been rendered prisoners, they will follow him. Jesus is our Savior. He is breaking the gates now. In the name of Jesus, he will break in the gates now. He will fight your battle. That's your destiny. That's your talent. That's your star that have been buried. Horobo Sereba. The breaker is coming. The breaker is coming. The breaker is coming. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. Call upon his name now. Call upon his name now. The Bible says, Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Whosoever shall call upon the name of Jesus shall be saved now. Call upon him now for your family, for your destiny, for your talents. Call on him now. Jesus, Jesus, open your mouth and pray now. Call on him now. Call on him now. Jesus, Oh, earth, hear the word of the Lord. Vomit my blessings. Vomit my blessings. According to Jeremiah chapter 22, verse 29. Oh, earth. Hey, vomit my blessings in the name of Jesus. My blessings in the sea. My talents buried in the sea. Ah, Jesus. Oh, see. Vomit my blessings in the name of Jesus. Pray now, my people. Pray now, my people. Enough is enough. My job, my promotions that have been kept in the limbo, that have been buried in the sea, that have been locked up in the sea, that have been swallowed in the ground, be broken now. Jesus, let the Lamb vomit them now. In the name of Jesus. Oh, as Jonah was vomited, by the fish that swallowed him, so I command every earth, every sea, every fish, every Goliath that has swallowed your destiny, that has swallowed your talents, I command them now. Vomit my blessings now. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Pray now, pray now, pray now. The power of God is flowing. The Lord is moving now. The word of God is moving now. My gift is going to be released now. My talents will be released. All my gifts are buried. I cancel every work of the devil against them now. In the name of Jesus. My people, receive that gift now. Receive that gift now. The gift of good health. Receive it right now. The gift of favor. Receive it now. Receive them now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Call upon him now. Call upon him now. He will answer you. He will answer you. He's a wonderful God. He's a mighty God. Jesus. Call on him now. He is a wonderful. The Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 20, verse 11. Oh, Jesus, that the Lord is with me like a mighty champion. Oh, Jesus, in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. And the Bible says, the Lord is with you like a mighty Savior. Oh, Jesus, he is both a champion and a Savior. He is fighting for you now. Call upon him now. Call upon him now. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, Jesus, call on him now. He will answer you. He will answer you. He's a wonderful God. He's a powerful God. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Right now, I begin to pray over you. People with a gift of prophecy, receive that gift now. Receive that gift now. In the name of Jesus. People with a gift of wisdom, receive that gift now. People with a gift of knowledge, receive that gift now. Receive the gift of faith in the name of Jesus. People that are supposed to have the gift of healing, receive that gift now in the name of Jesus. Jesus. People that are supposed to have the gift of miracles, receive the gift now. The gift of discernment, the gift of speaking tongues, receive them now. Jesus. And according to Romans chapter 12, verse 6 to 8, I prophesy upon you. Receive the gift of prophecy, receive the gift of servanthood, receive the gift of teaching. The gift of encouragement, the gift of exhortation, the gift of giving, the gift of leadership, the gift of compassion. Receive that gift now in the name of Jesus. Jesus, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27 to 31, I speak unto you to receive the gift of apostleship, the gift of assistance and helping people, the gift of administration in the name of Jesus. According to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 12, I speak unto you to receive the gift of evangelism, the gift of shepherding, in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. The power is flowing now. Receive him now. Receive him now. Jesus, touch our people. Touch our people. I want to bear fruit. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, let me bear fruit, in the name of Jesus. The good fruits, the fruit that lasts. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, yes, my Lord. Yes, my Lord. Let the gift you are giving to me make way for me. Let my gift make way for me. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Call on him now. Call on him now. Yes, my Lord. The power is flowing now. The Bible says, Proverbs 18, verse 16, that my gift will take me to the king palace. My gift will take me to great men. Hey, Father. Hey, Rabu Hereba. Let my gifts take me to the government. Take me to great men.
In the name of Jesus, let my gifts make way for me. In the name of Jesus, let my gifts make room for me. In the name of Jesus, 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 anywhere that my gifts have been locked up, let it manifest, let it come out. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Jesus. 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 Begin to cover your gifts with the blood of Jesus. Begin to cover your gifts with the blood of Jesus. Jesus, I call my gifts now with the blood of Jesus. I call my gifts now, the gifts of my children. I soak in the blood of Jesus. I cover with the blood of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Jesus. Yes, Lord. All my gifts, I soak in the blood of Jesus. I decree that no power of the devil will swallow my gifts again. In the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord. The Lord Jesus is fighting for me. In the name of Jesus. He's fighting for me. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I thank you now that you have delivered my gifts. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, El Shaddai. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Genesis chapter 44, we see the story of a silver cup in a sack. A silver cup in a sack. We're not going to take time to get into this because we don't have time again. But I want to let you know that Joseph put silver cup in the bag of grains that belongs to his youngest brother. Every person was having a bag of grains, a bag full of grains. But somebody had in that bag full of grains a silver cup. That is an extra blessing. That is an extra talent, an extra gift. Everybody is having the bag of grains, but somebody is having a silver inside. You know what it is like? That people are getting pregnant and they are having, you know, a baby in the womb. But your own, you're having quadruplets, twins, triplets, something extra, extra gifts. Because when your gifts, when you use your gifts, and God blesses the, and God will not start blessing you, God will add more to what you have when you are using your gift to serve God. He will add more. So we're going to pray and ask God to put a silver in your bag for you. The same way that Joseph put that silver cup in the sack of his brother. May Almighty God put silver, gold, diamonds, children, multiple children, blessings, promotion in your own sack of grains. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Oh, may Almighty God multiply us. May He preserve our blessings. There are people that the sack containing or carrying their blessings is porous. In other words, the enemy will take something and they rupture it, and your blessing, your gifts, your talent will begin to leak. Some time ago, I was in the spirit. While mass was going on, the Lord gave me the privilege to enter to the spirit. And I saw a sack full of coins. As I was admiring that bag, that sack of coins, which is a treasure, behold, I saw a knife that came and they ruptured the bag, the sack open, and all the coins just spilled out. There are people that their sack is leaking, leaking sacks, leaking uterus. You conceive, you have miscarriage, you don't know that your sack is leaking, that your uterus is leaking. Such children, such people, I am praying for you that every power that is causing your talent, your blessings, your glory, your testimonies, your promotions to leak out, I cancel in the name of Jesus. Oh, near success syndrome spirit that is leaking blessings. When something is about to mature, good thing, all of a sudden it will leak out. That is success syndrome. We are commanding some spirits to burn by fire. Holy Ghost! Fire! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I cover your sack of blessings, brother of Jesus. I soak your going and coming, brother of Jesus. Your gold, your silver, cup in the sack, who took the blood of Jesus, we declare that no weapon formed against us prosper in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. We cover ourselves, blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you for the administration of this night. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you have done today. We are grateful, O Lord. Blessed be your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, for exhuming and recovering our talents, our gifts. Thank you, Father, for not allowing the canker worms to eat them and swallow them. Blessed be your name, Papa, in Jesus' name. Amen.